The ACC is holding on for dear life, and the key to their survival past Florida State and Clemson is North Carolina.
You are Locked On College Football, your daily podcast on all things college football. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Locked On College Football. I'm your host, Spencer McLaughlin. Thank you so much for making this your first listen or your first view every day. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day, and your daily source to stay up to date with the biggest stories in the greatest sport on planet Earth. Realignment, coaching carousel, the portal, and more. We've always got you covered. Today's episode is brought to you by our friends at Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, use code Locked On College for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. We'll talk about how many SEC teams could make the playoff, and Friday Night Madness may just ensue on Fox this year. But let's start with North Carolina, because as the ACC has made it clear, they have got no intention, no incentive to settle with Florida State and Clemson. They're going to fight this out. They're going to try to make them stay. I have my doubts. Just given the history of how realignment's gone, I think they're going to find a way to leave. And you know what? The ACC has a path to surviving. If you look at what a reconstructed ACC looks like with Stanford, Cal, and SMU in the mix, and what the new look Big 12 is, at the very least, those leagues are comparable. You could argue about which one is better, which one's stronger, who's got better teams at the top, who's got bigger programs, better schools, better universities. Argue about that all you like. They are comparable. You cannot put a Grand Canyon-sized gap between those two leagues. But North Carolina is the key clog for the ACC for a couple reasons. Number one, there are legal ties to NC State. And the state of North Carolina as a whole, you've got North Carolina in there. You've got Duke in there. You've got Wake Forest in there. You've got NC State in there. The only school I feel like North Carolina would have any obligation to is Duke, except they have a literal obligation, at least in the eyes of the North Carolina Congress, to NC State. They can't just leave them behind. They'd have to be a wolf pack backpack, as someone coined, which is a pretty hilarious phrase. Would they want to do that? Would they want to put up with that extra hassle? Would they want to pay? If that's true, and there's no binding, or if there's no way to get out of that, and it is a binding arrangement at some level, would you be willing to, if you're North Carolina, pay what UCLA is paying to Cal in what's known as calimony? Because they're part of the UC system. UCLA left Cal behind. They're paying them $10 million a year. What if you get slapped with that sort of fight? Would you want to go forward with that? So that's the first thing, is if NC State and UNC are a package deal, I also have a hard time believing, maybe this is the traditionalist in me coming out, that North Carolina and Duke could not be in the same conference. No way. We've seen enough madness, but at the very least, with these moves, Texas and Oklahoma stayed together. Missouri and Kansas breaking up was a tragedy back in the day. Oregon and Washington have stayed together. USC and UCLA stayed together. Arizona schools have stayed together. Like, at the very least, there's some logic somewhere, sometimes. North Carolina and Duke can't play in different conferences. That does not feel right. And it wouldn't be right. And so that's the other element about this. I feel like North Carolina is a glue school. I think they can keep other schools interested. And then North Carolina as a university feels like one in which you can build a flagship conference around. Or they can be a flagship member of a conference that you can work to build it around. If Florida State and Clemson were to leave, which I suspect they will, and it's just a matter of time. Don't know what that time is. It's going to be a while. But let's say that happens. And they go off to the Big Ten. Can you build a conference that keeps everybody else interested around North Carolina, Miami, NC State, and Duke as kind of your top four? And then have other schools like Virginia Tech in the mix, or Syracuse in the mix. I'm just talking from a football standpoint. Pitt is still in the ACC. Louisville still in the ACC. Can you? That feels like a good enough league. That feels like it is on par, in the same realm, in the same conversation, in the same breath, the same caliber as what the new look Big 12 is going to be now and in the future. So I think you can do that. I think you have enough name brand recognition. I think you have a strong fan base there. I think you have big enough brands to build not just intriguing matchups, but games that people want to be a part of. Like, you want to play North Carolina. I don't know if North Carolina's got a villainous element to them outside of the basketball court, and these moves are primarily all driven by football there. But to me, North Carolina is a school that you can build a conference around. Is it going to be on par with the Big Ten, SEC? No, of course not. That's not what your goal would be. And here's the other incentivizing component. If you're Jim Phillips, the ACC commissioner, your pitch, once FSU and Clemson get out, if your legal team is unsuccessful and those billable hours feel like they have gone by the wayside and you've paid all that money for nothing, but that's just the way it goes in the court system. If that happens, there will be a settlement in there. Taking this more aggressive approach to try to get them to stay or force them to stay as members of the ACC, yeah, that would maybe be lower than it would have been if you took the approach that I came at it with, which was just go get the best settlement that you possibly can. And look, maybe that's how they feel behind the scenes, and they're posturing one way publicly and putting out all sorts of messaging to make it seem one way to try to give themselves leverage in the negotiations. Maybe. That's entirely possible. But if you go get a few $100 million, you can go to the remaining schools and say, you know that revenue gap that you're concerned about that's making you think about North Carolina, Miami, going to the Big Ten or the SEC, NC State, trying to get to the Power Two, Duke or Virginia Tech or Virginia or whomever else, Georgia Tech, whoever would be looking there. If you get a couple $100 million per school, that's a lot of money to throw around. I know there are a lot of distributions, but SMU, Cal, and Stanford already understand they're not getting diddly squat. So I don't know if you have to incentivize them. They don't have any leverage. They don't have any enforcement here. Like, they're new kids on the block. They're just happy to be there. They just want to be included. Craig Ferguson has a great joke about Canadians that he did in a stand-up routine. You make a joke about Canadians, they're not going to get offended. They're just happy to be included. Hey, he's talking about us. Yes, I know. We're on our way. That's Stanford, Cal, and SMU. We're just happy to be here. Just happy to be on TV. Happy to be in the ACC. They're not going to go and demand a chunk of that money. See, you kick out Florida State and Clemson. Well, not kick out, but you lose Florida State and Clemson. You give the money to everybody else, and suddenly that revenue gap that everyone's so worried about, that Florida State and Clemson want to get out of the ACC because of, suddenly they could help solve that problem and rectify it for the other remaining schools. But North Carolina is the key. The Duke connection, the NC State connection, and what they could mean to a future Atlantic Coast Conference. That is why North Carolina is the key. Drop your thoughts in the YouTube comments or hit me up on X, formerly known as Twitter, at SMcLaughlinCFB. We have a 12-team playoff this year. I don't care for it. I don't care for it. It is the reality, though, and so we shall discuss it. And how many SEC teams are getting in? Could it be five? Could you have five SEC? You could. We'll explore that next. You should go explore all the options over at FanDuel. It's winner take all time in the NBA and NHL, and FanDuel is giving you a shot to bring home a big win of your own. Right now, new customers get $150 in bonus bets with any winning $5 bet. That's $150 to bet on spreads, money lines, player props, and more. And everything you want for college football, win totals, make the playoff, miss the playoff, individual games, conference title odds, national championship odds, Heisman odds, it's all over there. It's all over there because FanDuel knows that college football is the greatest sport on planet Earth. And you can bet it right here, right now at the end of May. How fantastic is that? Go check them out. Visit FanDuel.com/LockedOn. Make every playoff shot count. FanDuel.com/LockedOn. FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook and our official sportsbook sponsor here at the Locked On Network. Five teams is a big number to put into the college football playoff. I don't think it's impossible. Hard, to be sure. Not impossible. Here are teams in the SEC that I feel and that Vegas feels are playoff caliber. You know, when I was putting together this list, I was this close. I mean this close to not putting Texas. That's an SEC school. Don't forget that. Georgia, Bama, Ole Miss, LSU, Tennessee, Texas, Missouri. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 teams in the SEC that are playoff caliber. Did you know that 3 of them are favored to make it? Georgia, Ole Miss, and Texas. And 4 of them are favored, pretty narrowly in most instances, to miss it. Alabama being favored to miss the college football playoff is a crazy world to live in. And look, for those of you that don't have experience with Kalen DeBoer, allow me to explain how this works. You look at what you have on paper and you feel really good. And you look at what the team he's coaching has on paper and you again feel good about what your team can put up, and then you lose. That's it. That's how it goes. That's how it has been the last several years. With Kalen DeBoer as a head coach in college football, ask, I don't know, anyone he's coached against. Michigan got the better of him. That's just about it. That's just, and randomly, 3-9 Arizona State in 2022. That's the last time Kalen DeBoer lost a football game before the national championship. Now he's at Alabama. And after their roster was kind of gutted in the early portion of the transfer portal cycle, they reloaded and they have brought in really good players. And I think this is going to be the worst Alabama team Kalen DeBoer coaches. And I think they're going at least 9-3. At least. Because that guy's a heck of a coach. Their schedule's not a cakewalk. That guy's a heck of a coach. Early in the year, though, it's not a huge threat. They do go to Wisconsin. I expect them to win that game. It's going to be an electric atmosphere, though. But still a crazy world to live in which Alabama's favored to miss the playoffs. So let's say the three teams that are favored to make it all fulfill on those expectations. Georgia, Texas, and Ole Miss. And let's say, just for the sake of argument, that Georgia and Texas play in the SEC title game. Georgia wins. They're, we'll call them, how many games is it? 13? We'll call them 12-1. Let's call Georgia 12-1, and let's call Texas 11-2. They're into the playoff. Let's say Ole Miss goes 10-2. They're into the playoff. I think that's a bare minimum. I think 3 is the bare minimum number of teams, because between Alabama, and it's hypothetical, between Alabama, LSU, Tennessee, and Missouri, do you think any of those teams are winning 10 games? Some of them are. They're not all going to be 10-win teams, but there are going to be several. I think whether they get 5 teams in, I think 4 is probably the number I would land on. Because I think 3 is a lock. I think 3 is an absolute lock. The teams that play in the SEC title game are into the playoff. Both of them. One will have a bye and one will not. Simple as that. Done. The team that missed it by a game, maybe Ole Miss loses to Georgia and goes 10-2 instead of 11-1. I really like Ole Miss this year with Lane Kiffin, Jackson Dart and company in their top-ranked transfer portal class. Guys like Walter Nolan along the defensive line, amongst others. I really like that Ole Miss roster. Let's say they go 10-2. In. They're absolutely in. Are those going to be the only 10-win teams? Maybe. Maybe they beat up on each other a little bit. Maybe everyone is good enough to be at that level, but not good enough to push through. I think 3 is the minimum. I think 5 is the maximum that the SEC could get in. That's why my bet is probably going to be on 4. Now, the Big Ten, when you look at the other playoff spots, you're going to have 5 conference champions, right? Those are automatics. The SEC and Big Ten runners-up, probably also in. Remember, you don't have divisions in the Big Ten anymore. So you're probably going to have at least a 10-3 team, that loses the Big Ten title game at like after the game, that'll be their record 10-3. Could very well be 11-2. You could have a pair of 11-1 teams in the Big Ten. The top two favorites are Ohio State and Oregon. If you have two 11-win Big Ten teams, they're both in. The number three team, I mean, that's Penn State acting as Brucey in The Longest Yard. My time to shine. 10-2. As Joel Klatt eloquently puts it, forever a bridesmaid in the playoff, not the bride. But this year, everyone's a bride. You get a playoff spot. You get a playoff spot. Thanks, Oprah. So Penn State could very easily be in. I think three is the number that the Big Ten likely ends up at. So if you go three from the Big Ten, one from the group of five, that's four. The Big 12 champion, the ACC champion, that's six. You got six spots left. I think Notre Dame, they're favored to make the playoff. More likely than not, I would put them in. Assuming, as I talked about recently on the show, if they beat Texas A&M week one, I think Notre Dame's making the playoff. I think it is that simple because they will not lose all of their big games the rest of the year, and they go 10-2, they'll be in. So let's just do some counting here. Three Big Ten, one Big 12, I think one ACC, maybe two. I think the ACC is more likely to get two teams in than the Big 12, but I also think one could very easily be the number there. You got one ACC, one Big 12, that's two. One group of five, that's three. And then three Big 10, that's six. And then Notre Dame is seven. The spots are there. The spots are there. This will come down to what the committee thinks about a 9-3 SEC team or a 9-3 Big 10 team. Or, you know, if you're thinking outside the box, another 11-1 group of five team that maybe has a quality non-conference win somewhere, or what do they think about a 10-2 Big 12 team? If the Big 12 doesn't have a lot of teams in the top 25, or an ACC team, do they put somebody else into the mix? They certainly could. I think you've got a handful of playoff caliber teams, but are they going to have playoff caliber seasons? That's an important distinction. You see teams every single year think Georgia a season ago. They were playoff caliber as a team. Didn't have a playoff caliber season. Florida State, playoff caliber team. Did not have a playoff caliber season. And I know that will get some people all sorts of hot and bothered. They won all their games. They would have been blasted. Everyone knows it. You know it. I know it. Everybody knows it. You just don't want to admit it. But you know what? That's okay. We don't need to go back down that particular rabbit hole there. I think five is the maximum number of teams the SEC could get in. I think it's at least three and probably four. But one thing that I'm really fascinated to see, even though, as I stated, I'm not a fan of the 12-team playoff, doesn't mean there aren't going to be interesting components or exciting elements to it. Home playoff games, electric. Electric. Frankly, don't know why we didn't think of that in the 14 playoff, because that's quality stuff. Now, in the 14 playoff, maybe it made less sense because you're kind of looking at, you know, different conference champions and playing them in bowl game destinations, and I understand all that. But one of maybe my favorite element of a 12-team playoff, home campus playoff games. Yep. Give me that. That's going to be great. That is absolutely going to be great. I don't like what that means for the regular season. I like what it means for those games meaning something at that time of year. There will be high drama and big games and big plays and all this sort of stuff. And then everyone will just lose to the top teams in the country. But let's ignore that right now. What I'm interested to see, how does the committee value a 9-3 Big Ten or a 9-3 SEC? That's going to be crucial to determine who gets those at-large spots. Because I think three from the Big Ten and three from the SEC are locks. And three from the other conferences combined are locks. That's 9 of the 12. What do you see in those other spots? We're going to find out. Season is under 100 days away. Isn't that exciting? Indeed, it is. Speaking of the season, there are going to be Friday night kickoffs. I love Friday night kickoffs when they're not happening to my team. Sort of, kind of. We could have madness, including a potential upset in the Big 12. Coming up next. This episode of Locked On College Football brought to you by our friends over at Game Time. With killer last-minute deals, all-in prices, views from your seat, and their lowest price guarantee, Game Time takes the guesswork out of buying NBA tickets. Say you want to go to Game 2 between the Timberwolves and the Mavericks, then guess what? Game Time is the place to go. If you want to attend the Eastern Conference Finals or the NBA Finals, which will probably be the Celtics, and I hope the Timberwolves. I really do. I really, really do. The Wolves deserve it. But you can find everything you want over at Game Time. Save up to 60% off buying last minute for sports, concerts, comedy, theater, etc. You can save even more with exclusive in-app deals. Just go check them out. They take the guesswork out of buying NBA tickets. That is what Game Time is about. Download the Game Time app, create an account, use code LOCKEDONCOLLEGE for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account, redeem code LOCKEDONCOLLEGE. College, all one word, college in all caps for $20 off. That's Locked On College. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. Friday night football kickoffs over the years have had a tendency to either fly under the radar or be the wildest, craziest things you've ever seen. Last year, I believe Stanford and Colorado was a Friday night kickoff in Boulder, and Colorado blew something in the neighborhood of a 29-0 lead. I remember many years ago, Richie Bradshaw of Locked On Sun Devils is going to hate me for bringing this up, but 2015, Oregon at Arizona State, Vernon Adams basically pulls off a 30-yard Hail Mary in which Dwayne Stafford caught the ball sliding on his rear end, catching it behind him to tie the game, send it to overtime. There was a controversial call. Anyway, Oregon won. So I look at this lineup of Friday night kickoffs that got released. I think we could have some madness. And the one that jumps off the page for an upset here is Utah at UCF. Utah are my favorites and everybody's favorite to win the Big 12 this season. Why? Because on paper, they're the best team. That should not have been an 8-win team a year ago, but they were because Kyle Whittingham's great. They bring Brant Keithy back at tight end to support, you know, Cam Rising, who in his last two seasons of starting college football won the Pac-12, which was deeper than, or I don't know if deeper is the right word. It was stronger than this current iteration of the Big 12, which is a very deep conference. But if you put this Big 12 against the Pac-12s that Cam Rising won, those Pac-12 conferences were better. So that guy was Kyle Whittingham. They're the favorites. On Friday, November 29th, they go at UCF. Do not in the slightest overlook this football game. UCF, I have talked about them before here on the show. They have been making some real transfer portal moves. They're not acting like a Big 12 team that is shaking off the Group of Five label. They're acting like a Big 12 team that wants to jump forward in the timeline. They want to take the time stone from Doctor Strange and just, you know, like Thanos with the gauntlet. They want to just twist it forward and say, yeah, all right, we're primetime recruiter. We're bringing big time portal names to the program and we're ready to go out. They have a win total of 7.5. 7.5. Do you know who else has a win total of 7.5 in the Big 12? Allow me to illustrate. Oklahoma State, Mike Gundy, one of the best coaches in all of college football, win total of 7.5. Arizona, trendy Big 12 title contender and playoff dark horse. I am not high on the Wildcats going into this year. I think they've lost just a little bit too much, but they made another move recently. Picked up a former top 150 player at the running back position from Ole Miss. Don't hate that move whatsoever. Still, I don't think Wildcats can live up to the hopes that they would have had if Jed Fish had stuck around. But they have the same win total as UCF. They're just not the same. They're not the same as Houston, Cincinnati, and BYU, who are fighting their way out of the bottom of the league right now. And I don't know how successful any of them are going to be. Willie Fritz, year one of a rebuild. Cincinnati, not real high expectations. BYU, I like Kalani Sitake. Don't love the quarterback room in any way, shape, or form. But you've got KJ Jefferson, who has Power 5 starting and winning experience and a non-traditional power in the SEC like Arkansas, coming over to UCF. You bring in Penny Boone at the running back position amidst a variety of other transfers. Then we got Nigel Kelly, the defensive end from Miami, who entered the portal, former blue chip guy. That game, late in the year, Friday night kickoff at Central Florida. This is not a game that is going to be played inside the cozy confines of Rice-Eccles Stadium for the Utes. They have to go on the road of all these Friday night kickoffs. Think about the last several college football seasons. Do you remember a year in which Friday nights haven't featured a legitimate upset or a crazy game? You're going to have that this year. The lineup on Fox goes like this. Starting Friday, September 13th. Maybe I should have led with that. Perhaps that was the big takeaway from this lineup of Friday night games. There's a Friday the 13th football game. It's Arizona at Kansas State, by the way. That game's in Manhattan. Give me Kansas State. Early prediction. That might be the first game prediction that I have made here on the show, but I like Kansas State more than I like Arizona, and Kansas State's at home. So that's the first game. Is that important enough for you? Oh, we're just getting warmed up. Illinois at Nebraska. Matt Rule better not lose that game. Washington at Rutgers. That's a Big Ten conference game. Washington. I'm not a meteorologist, but it would look something like this. Over here in this part of the country, those watching on YouTube are getting this, we have Washington. And then Piscataway is like over here. It's way, 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 way over there. That's a conference game now. Long trip. Never know. Rutgers was a bowl team last year. Don't sleep. Washington's having a soft reset, I'll say. They've done a nice job in the transfer portal. Michigan State at Oregon. Jonathan Smith has surprised Dan Lanning once before. That is all I shall say. Northwestern at Maryland. Oregon at Purdue. Yeah, I stopped on that one. Stopped on that. Oregon at Purdue. Have you ever seen a top five team lose at Purdue? I have Friday night game in West Lafayette. Ooh, boy. Kind of spicy. Rutgers at USC. That's a late kickoff, by the way. That game, talk about utilizing the Western time zone. Rutgers at USC, 11 p.m. Eastern kick at the Coliseum. Iowa at UCLA. Now, there's an interesting football game. Just because it's Iowa on the road, I don't expect much from UCLA. They're at home. You never know. UCLA at Washington. That's a Big Ten matchup now. Purdue at Michigan State. Not the biggest stakes. Utah at UCF and then the Mountain West Championship, which will probably feature Boise State, but is not guaranteed to do so. So that's the Friday night slate. I think it's great. Now, are Saturdays paramount? Are they the most important? Yes, of course. Of course, of course, of course. Saturday is what we care about above all else. But impact games and wonderful appetizers regularly take place on Friday nights. And I think that lineup of games will feature some crazy ones. Like the games that don't have the biggest stakes, Northwestern, Maryland, Purdue, Michigan State, for instance, Iowa, UCLA, that one maybe a touch bigger, but Illinois, Nebraska. It feels like one of those games that doesn't have a top 10 team in it is just going to go bonkers. It's just got like Colorado Stanford last year. It just went, it was drunk. It deserved a Kevin Harlan. The guy is drunk, but there he goes. The game was blacked out, okay? It was not a brownout drunk. It was not feeling woozy. No, that was blackout drunk. That's what it was. One of those games is going to happen on there. But the upset that I'd watch for on that list, sorry to say, Utah fan, I'm not saying I'm picking it. It's too early for predictions, except Kansas State over Arizona and Manhattan on Friday the 13th. Going to be a good football game, I would imagine. UCF against Utah, could they at least play spoiler this year? That late in the year, Utah will be a Big 12 title contender. We shall find out. Season is under 100 days away. It's a beautiful thing. Appreciate everyone listening. I will see you next time. And until then, hope you have a wonderful rest of your day.